The ministry we share is none other than the sacrificial ministry of Christ, who gave himself up to death on the cross for the salvation of the world. By his glorious resurrection, he has opened for us the way of everlasting life. By the gift of the Holy Spirit, he shares with us the riches of his grace. We are called to proclaim his death and resurrection, to administer the sacraments of the new covenant, which he sealed with his blood on the cross, and to care for his people in the power of the Spirit. Do you hear in the presence of Christ and his church renew your commitment to your ministry under the pastoral direction of your bishop?
I do.
You reaffirm your promise to give yourselves prayer and study.
I do.
You reaffirm your promise so to minister the word of God and the sacraments of the new covenant that the reconciling love of Christ may be known and received.
I do.
You reaffirm your promise to be a faithful servant of all those committed to your care, patterning your life in accordance with the teachings of Christ, so that you may be a wholesome example to your people.
I do.
Now, as your bishop, I too before God and you rededicate myself and reaffirm the promises that I made when I was ordained. I ask your prayers. Together may the Lord,
who has given us the will to do these things, give us also the grace and power to perform them.
And may the peace of the Lord
also with you.
As you all know, in our new revised common lectionary, which is used by pretty much the whole Episcopal Church, this lesson from the Gospel of John is for the Tuesday in Holy Week for year A, B, and C. It's the same one. We hear the same story year after year in that passion time in Jesus' teaching, his last teaching. It's about Philip and Andrew and Jesus and some Greeks. Some inquisitive Greeks wanting to see this rabbi, to just see him or ask him a few questions, or maybe sit down and discuss some philosophy, but engage him, get to know him. These were forerunners into his church and his kingdom, these Gentiles. And in a way, I think his heart jumped, and he would say, it started, something's happening. His life's work maybe hadn't been in vain. He had broken down some barriers with some people that he wasn't supposed to deal with. And with that, the belief, the knowledge he had broken through to the Gentiles, he goes on to lay down a really important cornerstone, a law of life for him and for his disciples. There's a way of life that's found in verse 24 and 25. Jesus is our model for these verses. In all things and in all ways, he had given to others and to God. When we give ourselves to others and to God, we gain life. We can go to bed at night feeling maybe exhausted, but we've accomplished something. You all as clergy in this diocese have given so much and sacrifice so much. And I hope that you feel good. Back to the request of the Greeks. I'm drawn to these words simply because of their relevance today. We don't have maybe many people coming to us or the church saying, sir, ma'am, may we see Jesus? We have stacks and stacks of surveys that tell us that people aren't asking that question. But there are people who are asking other questions about the meaning of life and how do they connect with that. And maybe is there some other connection beyond themselves and another person? They're struggling. And we who love Jesus, like Philip and Andrew, are still being asked to help others to see Jesus. Still today, people, by and large, recognize who and what we are because of our outer appearance. How many times have you been asked, are you a minister? One time I wasn't thinking. I said, no, I'm a bishop. So then if you're not a minister and you're not a Christian, what's a bishop? No, I don't want to go there. And we know our Lord is seen by others. Those Greeks among us today, by our service to others. Not for our own benefit, but for Christ's sake. Sir, we wish to see Jesus. And I would say, yes, come. I want you to meet these other people here, because they will see Jesus